My name is Amanda Sleeper. I live in Landenburg, Pennsylvania. I have a PhD in neurobiology and pharmacology from Yale University. And I wanted to talk to you a little bit about water fluoridation. I first became interested in water fluoridation about 7 years ago when my family decided to have everybody do a test called the LCAT. This is a test that looks at non-allergic reactions to food and chemicals. And when I got the results of my test, the company told me that I had the most severe reaction to fluoride that they had ever seen. I was really surprised by this because I had never heard that you could have a reaction to fluoride. It's in the water, and it's, you know, been around for years, so it just didn't seem possible to me. I went ahead and started reading, and I found out that the dental benefits of fluoride are actually somewhat controversial, and that there is a small but significant portion of the population that is hypersensitive to fluoride and can have a variety of reactions to the chemical, from headaches and digestive distress to fatigue, brain fog, and other symptoms. So I wasn't sure whether or not I had symptoms of fluoride sensitivity, but the company recommended strongly that I change my dental products and remove fluoride from cooking and drinking water and to see if it had any impact on my health. So this was difficult to do. Fluoride is hard to remove from water when it's there. You have to use a distillation process or reverse osmosis. But I bought a distiller and I gave it a try. And within about a week to a month, I realized that my energy was very much improved. I never knew I could have that much energy. All through my childhood and adult life, I would get multiple illnesses every winter, respiratory infections that would last for weeks. They would need to be treated with antibiotics. And I would spend just as much time in the winter being sick as I did healthy. But in the winter following, when I removed fluoride from my water, I was much, much healthier. I don't think I used one antibiotic and maybe had one small cold. And that's been the case for the past number of years. I have had nowhere near the infections that I had before I cut fluoride out of my diet. So that was really interesting to me. Another symptom that I realized I had was irritation and inflammation in my hands. Every winter, my hands would get chapped and red and inflamed to the point where people would say to me, "Oh my gosh, what happened to your hands?" When I cut the fluoride out, that redness went away and it's never come back. So I feel strongly that that skin reaction was related to the fluoride. In retrospect, I do have dental fluorosis, which my dentist had tried to address cosmetically, but streaking, like a light brown streaking in the front of my teeth, as well as some white patches that are really hyper white. And that's something that was a clue that this really was going on and something real for me. So I guess what I would like to say to you is that I think it's important to think carefully about putting fluoride into the drinking water. There is a population, a percentage of the population that's sensitive, and quality of life can be incredibly impacted if that fluoride is there. And again, it's something that's not necessary to have in the water. If you believe that fluoride is important for dental health, there are a number of ways to get fluoride aside from the drinking water. But if you're a person like me who needs to, for health reasons, avoid fluoride, when it's in the water, there's almost nothing you can do. It's not a situation where you can have informed consent for that dental treatment. So I think that you should use caution in moving forward. Think carefully about the decision. There's a growing body of evidence that fluoride is a neurotoxin and impacts the IQ of unborn babies and has long-term effects throughout our lives on our cognitive function. And it's a risk that just doesn't quite seem worth the benefit when there are other ways of addressing dental health.